The Lord be with you. At this time, I ask that the children and youth come forward and help us with our noisy offering for our Do Unto Others Fund. One more of you could go over to the left side. There might be even more change on this side. We don't know. While they are doing that, thank you for supporting our Do Unto Others Fund and the ministry that it does. I'd like to welcome all visitors this morning. I do want to acknowledge Pastor Craig Peterson, assistant to the bishop. And have him stand up. Let's welcome him with a round of applause. And I just have to share with you, he happens to have been born and raised in Starbuck, Minnesota. And we know that counts for a little bit here, doesn't it, Lillian? So, yeah. He'll be participating in the worship service towards the end and bringing greetings from the Minneapolis Area Synod. And all visitors are welcome today. There you go. Thank you for helping us give to God. Yeah. There you go. Thank you for helping us give to God. Please stand for confession and forgiveness. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, who stretches out the heavens, who sends light to the nations, who gives breath to us all. Amen. Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. Loving God, we confess that we have turned from your way to follow our own ways. Forgive us for the times we have spoken or acted too quickly. We have not spoken or acted at all. We have hurt those closest to us. We have hurt those we have yet to know. We have thought more about ourselves than others. We have thought less of ourselves than we ought. Turn us around and give us a fresh start, so that we can live again as your children. Amen. Even when we have done wrong, God makes us right. Even when we have messed up, God puts us together. God's love never runs out. God never tires of calling us beloved children. Hear God say to you now, your sins are forgiven. For the sake of Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. Please join in singing with our worship team.
I will obey, but my life is all I have and all I will give.
We invite you to pray together with us the prayer of the day. O God, in the transfiguration of your Son, you confirm the mysteries of the faith by the witness of Moses and Elijah, and in the voice from the bright cloud declaring Jesus your beloved Son, you foreshadowed our adoption as your children. Make us heirs with Christ of your glory, and bring us to enjoy its fullness. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. You may be seated as we continue singing. Please stand for the gospel acclamation as we prepare to hear the word of the Lord.
The lesson is from Luke chapter 12, verses 28 to 45. Now, about 8 days after these sayings, Jesus took with him Peter and John and James and went up on the mountain to pray. And while he was praying, the appearance of his face changed and his clothes became dazzling white. Suddenly, they saw two men, Moses and Elijah, talking to him. They appeared in glory and were speaking of his departure, which he was about to accomplish at Jerusalem. Now Peter and his companions were weighted down with sleep. But since they had stayed awake, they saw his glory and the two men who stood with him. Just as they were leaving him, Peter said to Jesus, "Master, it is good for us to be here. Let us make three dwellings, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah," not knowing what he said. While he was saying this, a cloud came and overshadowed them, and they were terrified as they entered the cloud. Then from the cloud came a voice that said, "This is my son, my chosen. Listen to him." When the voice had spoken, Jesus was found alone, and they kept silent, and in those days, told no one of the things they had seen. On the next day, when they came down from the mountain, a great crowd met him. Just then, a man from the crowd shouted, "Teacher, I beg you to look at my son. He is my only child." Suddenly, a spirit seizes him, and all at once, he shrieks. It convulses him until he foams at the mouth. It mauls him and will scarcely leave him. "I begged your disciples to cast it out, but they could not." Jesus answered, "Your faithless and perverse generation, how much longer must I be with you and bear with you? Bring your son here." While he was coming, the demon dashed him to the ground in convulsions. But Jesus rebuked the unclean spirit, healed the boy, and gave him back to his father. And all were astounded at the greatness of God. While everyone was amazed at all he was doing, he said to his disciples, "Let these words sink into your ears. The Son of Man is going to be betrayed into human hands." But they did not understand this saying. Its meaning was concealed from them, so that they could not perceive it. And they were afraid to ask him about this saying. This is the word of the Lord.
You may be seated, and we invite the children up for children's message. children, today we're talking about a very special time, a very special moment in the life of Jesus and the disciples. And I'd like to share that story with you. It's entitled, Jesus is Changed on the Mountaintop. Jesus said to his closest friends, Peter, James, and John, come with me to the mountaintop to pray. They climbed for hours and hours and hours until their legs ached, just like some people's legs are aching this morning from skiing all day yesterday. At last they were at the top. Jesus' face began shining with a light as bright as the sun, and his clothes seemed to glow. Moses and Elijah, two great leaders who had died long ago, appeared next to Jesus and began to talk with him. Peter and his friends were stunned. Lord, Peter gasped, we are blessed to be here. Let me build houses and we can stay in this wonderful place forever. But even as he was speaking, a bright cloud came down and covered them all. A voice spoke from the cloud. This is my son who fills me with joy. I love him. Listen to what he says. Peter and James and John covered their heads and threw themselves on the ground in fear. Jesus touched them gently on the shoulder. The cloud had gone, and Jesus was alone with them. We cannot stay on the mountaintop, Jesus said. We must return to the valley where God's children need us. Which ones do you think are the disciples? Remember, they covered their heads? This one? And maybe this one? And this one? And which one is Jesus? The one in the middle? And which one do you think is Moses? The one with the big book? And which one would be Elijah? Which one looks like, yeah, you're right. Now, I was studying this picture and something dawned on me. Look at the picture of Moses. And look at the picture of the man who wrote the story. What color is this man?
Brown.
And what color is Moses? Brown or black? They call brown people black, don't they? Yeah. And you know what? It's the same man.
Wait, this is Moses?
No. His name is Bishop Desmond Tutu, and he's a great, great leader of the church. And the person who painted this picture put him in the painting as Moses, because he's kind of a contemporary Moses. Pretty neat, huh? All God's children have a place with Jesus, don't they? Doesn't matter what color you are, you can be a great, great leader for Jesus. Let's fold our hands and bow our heads and close our eyes and pray after me. Dear God, help me to share your glory with others. Go in peace and serve the Lord Jesus. Amen. Lillian, I have a confession to make. First of all, thank you for your generous gift to our congregation just before I came, but I've never been able to see the clock that she gave up there that's on the back. I've never been able to read it properly. So, you know, I figured I can go all day long today. You know, what can you do? Fire me? You know? So I'll try to keep it, you know, within a reasonable distance. And if we get to an hour, somebody please stand up to remind me that we do have to end worship today sometime. Okay. Let's pray. Gracious God, we thank you for our partnership in the gospel. We thank you for this time that we've had together. And you have called us by the Holy Spirit to be brothers and sisters in Christ. And we know that we're never going to lose that, that we will renegotiate our relationship, but that we will always be friends and brothers and sisters in Christ. And we pray, Lord Jesus, that as Peter and John and James saw you on the mountaintop, that we would always see you and follow you. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. When I was young, I loved to play ball, and back in those days, playing ball meant baseball at the park, Longfellow Park, actually. And we'd go to play baseball, and do you ever remember this, where you started, I don't know who decided who the two captains would be, but, you know, you'd throw a bat to the other guy, and they had to catch it heavy side down, and then you would play that game where you alternated hands until you got to the very top, to the knob at the very top, and whoever was the one at the very top got to choose first. Or were you ever forced to stand in line in the gym, and the teacher chose the two captains, and they were usually the best athletes, or the teacher's pets? Never happens, does it? And sides were chosen, and you stood there, and you waited and waited, hoping and praying that you wouldn't be the absolute last one, you know, the loser at the end. When I was in grade school, I was never, ever the first one chosen. Had to stand in line with everybody else, dying of embarrassment, red-faced, waiting patiently as the line grew shorter and shorter. And I'd be praying fervently, and finally one of the captains would look at me and said, like it was the last thing that he wanted to do in the world, Grant. So whenever I've come across this text in the on Transfiguration Sunday, I've been jealous of Peter and John and James, because they got chosen first. And I've wondered what the other disciples felt like. You know, when Jesus called out Peter and John and James, I want you to come with me. You other ones, you just stay behind. Well, I can imagine that there were kind of unholy thoughts that ran through their heads. Well, why them? Why not me? That's not fair. It should be all of us, Jesus. Why did they get chosen? Why are they special? What do they have that I don't have? Well, we do not know why Jesus called Peter and John and James. All we know is that Jesus did. What we do know, this is the gospel truth, is that Jesus has chosen you. Now, sometimes we wonder and we speculate why the rest of the world hasn't chosen Jesus, why the rest of the world doesn't believe in Jesus, and that's kind of clouded in mystery, isn't it? Now, what we do know is the gospel truth. To you, Jesus has invited to follow and said, follow me, and you have followed. You are a Christian, a follower of Christ. Now, we have this kind of, there's a feeling amongst a lot of Christians in our world today that their life is a mess, a total mess. And if they only get their life right with Jesus, if they only believe in Jesus hard enough, then all that will disappear. And life will be a life of tranquility and ease and peace. And I would imagine Peter and John and James probably thought the same thing. Wow, you know, we're being picked out. Wonder what Jesus has special for us. Is it going to be a better life than everyone else? A peaceful life, an easy life? So they followed him. Kind of maybe even looking back at the others. You know, we're going, you aren't, we're going. And then Jesus pointed to the top of a mountain. Imagine the top of a mountain like Mount Everest. And said, follow me. What? What, Jesus? Up there? Up to the top of that mountain? You got to be kidding me. Follow me. Remember what I said, if anyone want to come after me, let them pick up their cross and follow me. Now, have you ever climbed a mountain? I've climbed up to the tea house at, where was that? Lake Louise. That's about as high as I ever got on a mountain, but never to the top. But all I know is that when you climb a mountain, it's hard work. It's hard, physical, strenuous, difficult, challenging work. And so is the Christian journey. I've got news for you. Following Jesus is never going to be easy. It's going to demand sacrifice. You're going to be asked to give up many things. You will face dangers and trials and tribulations you never thought were possible, and others don't have to go through. All because you've heard the Holy Spirit. All because you've heard the voice of Jesus saying, follow me. And you have followed. You have followed Jesus. No matter what the cost, to the top of the mountain. The life of faith is not easy, but when you reach the top of that mountain, the rewards are so great. There stood Jesus in all his glory, transfigured, transformed, like white and bright, like a ray of flashing light, lightning. And then a voice spoke the words, this is my son, my chosen. Listen to him. Brothers and sisters in Christ, in the last 3 years and 6 months, there's been times I've been to that mountaintop. There's been times when you and I have been on top of that mountain and beheld Jesus among us. I've seen Jesus at that baptismal font when a little baby girl was brought in the most beautiful tiny little dress. Her parents born in a foreign country. White dress, white as Jesus was that day. And when I baptized her in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, I saw tears of joy running down Mom and Dad's face. I have seen Jesus when a man who can barely walk, who was born that way at birth, came up here with his walker, and we all watched as he slowly stood up, and he made his way with great, great exertion to the front to receive Jesus in the Lord's Supper. I have seen Jesus when, through you, I was able to help a man through the Duo Fund, a man who has a criminal record you don't want to know about. But we have a secretary who bravely welcomed him, and we got to know each other. And I saw a man slowly transform through the work of the Holy Spirit. Who, I don't know if you remember that Sunday, dared to interrupt our worship service and come right to the front and say, "I want to witness, I want to testify." And he told us about Jesus and said, "That's my pastor," and gave me a huge hug. I have seen Jesus when the first time I went out to share the peace, I walked into the congregation, and here was a woman who was lives with mental challenges. And I said, "The peace of the Lord," and there was this wonderful smile, and she gave me a great big bear hug, and she wouldn't let go. And I was like, "Now what do I do?" But what a joyous sharing of the peace. I have seen Jesus when this summer, this foolish pastor suggested that perhaps on God's Work Our Hands Sunday, we could all get together and paint the church. "For Pete's sakes, Pastor, don't you know we're all old around here? And we don't have that many people. And not anybody ever shows up to help with things like that." And that Sunday after church, we all went outside, and people came from all over, young and old alike, and grabbed a paintbrush, and we worked, and we worked, and we worked. We never took a break, if I remember. And when sunset came, we stood and looked back, and we were amazed. Working together as the body of Christ, we painted the church. Almost, almost. I found a few spots. So did other people, but we got close. I have seen Jesus when we came together, three congregations for a Christmas program, white and black, and it didn't matter. Lutherans and Nigerians and confirmation kids from Atonement, and we did not just one, but two Christmas programs that day, all to the glory of God. I have seen Jesus when this little congregation, through a lot of hard work and planning by our director of music and our secretary and myself and others, this past Christmas, did two worship services with orchestration, two different Christmas worship services back to back, each one vastly different from the other. Christmas Eve, worshiping the newborn King. Christmas Day, celebrating and proclaiming his birth. I think we sang in 8 different languages that day. And you were a part of that and came together doing the liturgy, the work of God's people, singing together praise and glory to Jesus. And after each worship service, I had visitors tell me, "Pastor, that worship service was so wonderful. If we lived in the area, we would join tonight." I have seen Jesus when the Sunday after Valentine's Day this year, unscripted, unplanned, surprising us all, three children who struggle day to day with autism stood at the back at the door, and as we walked out, they handed us handmade, full-size Valentine's Day cards saying, "Happy Valentine's Day, Jesus loves you." It doesn't get any better than that. I've seen Jesus in those moments. Lives that were just a precious holy moment have been transformed. I've seen Jesus in the faces of y'all. Or have I? Is it truly Jesus? Or in my sinful state, is it just a reflection of what I want to see face to face or wish to see? Or as Martin Luther loved to rain on our parade by saying, "How do we know it's of God or of the evil one?" Well, we don't, do we? That's the truth. But we walk by faith and not by sight. But what I saw, I believe to be Jesus. Perhaps we're seeing in a mirror dimly, but the day is coming when we will see Jesus face to face. For all who dare to follow Jesus, all who dare to answer his call, "Come follow me." All who dare to fight through the pain and the suffering and the sacrifice and all the enormous amounts of energy and enthusiasm, a determination that it takes to make this journey of faith. When we follow Jesus as our guide up that mountain, the day is going to come for us all when we will see Jesus, Jesus only. In the words of one of my all-time favorite songs, I can only imagine what it would be like when we walk by your side. I can only imagine what our eyes will see when your face is before us. I can only imagine, surrounded by your glory, what will our heart feel? Will we dance for you, Jesus, or in awe of you be still? Will we stand in your presence, or to our knees will we fall? Will I sing alleluia? Will I be able to speak at all? I can only imagine. I can only imagine what it's going to be like with that great cloud of witnesses that has gone before us. Until that day, brothers and sisters in Christ, we walk by faith, not by sight. Yet with Jesus as our guide, we're going to make it up that mountain. Professor Paul Sonnick was my seminary faculty advisor. My cousin Tinka sitting here. We met for the very first time, the first day of seminary for both of us. Much to our embarrassment, the president of the whole thing made us stand up. Remember that day, Tinka? says, "You can't believe what just happened." By the time we reached seminary, Paul Sonic was a kind of a crusty old guy, but well-loved, great sense of humor, and had a tendency to have a foul mouth. He actually was trying to clean it up, but he was failing now and then. He once told our group that his goal at seminary was to destroy every shred of pietism in every student that came. And he often succeeded. It was our final quarter or semester of seminary as seniors. It was a warm spring day. We were sitting in his church history class, trying to stay awake as he lectured about the development of the Christian church across America. And all of a sudden, he just stopped in mid-sentence. And he stared at us, and he stared at his pile of books and his notes. And then he angrily threw his papers and his books on the floor and he said, "I don't know why I'm talking about all this crap." Whoa, that kind of wakes you up. We just kind of straightened up and said, "What in the world's going on here?" Then he looked at us. He said, "Seniors, I want to tell you what it's all about." And he talked about what it's going to be like when we served as pastors. That we weren't going to live an easy life, that we were going to fill our lives with very difficult challenges, and it was going to be a struggle. It was going to be a hard life, a lonely life, a life that few understood, that very few knew about. And he talks about some of the joys and rewards that he had experienced. But then he said, "Let me tell you what it's all about." And here was this foul-mouthed, swearing professor who shocked us all when he said, "Really, it's about Jesus. Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me, for the Bible tells me so." Bring! The bell rang, just as if on cue. And we all sat there in silence. In the holy moment, for quite a long time, no applause. One senior made his way out, then another one, then we all just left that holy place. Never to forget it. Brothers and sisters in Christ, Jesus loves you. This I know. Yes, Jesus loves you. Yes, Jesus loves you. Yes, Jesus loves you. For the Bible tells me so. Never, ever forget that. Amen. The peace of Christ, which passes all understanding, will keep our hearts and minds in Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen. Please stand as we sing our hymn of the day.